Hey guys, welcome back. This video is about the topic root mean squared, that is RMS value of a voltage wave and a current wave. If you studied this derivation from the textbook but that formula doesn't make any sense to you, then this is the video for you. The textbook derivation looks like that presented here, and the end result says if you divide a voltage wave or a current wave by root 2, you get the RMS value. I'm going to prove the same result by taking a much more practical approach. But before starting, let's take a quick look at the definition of RMS value, which reads, RMS value of an alternating current or voltage is that steady current or voltage which, when flowing through a given resistance for a given time, produces the same amount of heat as that produced by an alternating current when flowing through the same resistance for the same time. Now, since we are talking of heat, we are talking about terms like V squared or I squared, since the formula for heat is given by H equals V squared by R into T, or H equals I squared R into T. So I'm going to consider both the waves AC and DC, square them up because we are talking of V squared or I squared, and compare their areas to see at what magnitude do both the areas match up. Alright, so consider a XY plane and a DC signal with a magnitude M. Add AC signal with a peak of same magnitude, that is M. And let the time period under consideration be 2 pi. This RMS parameter is related to heating property, and heat produced in a conductor is given by I square R, which can also be written as equal to V square by R. So no matter you consider voltage or current, in either of the two cases, you have to consider the square of the wave. To start with the comparison, let us square the DC wave and the AC wave. The magnitudes will be higher this time because of squaring the terms, and in case of AC, the negative section will turn positive. The area under the squared DC wave will be M square multiplied by 2 pi, and the area occupied by the AC wave will be integration of M sin x the whole square over the complete cycle, that is from 0 to 2 pi. If you simplify this, the area will turn out to be m square into pi, and this is clearly not the same area which is occupied by the DC wave. In fact, it is lesser than the actual wave by 2 square units. Now, if both the sources are producing the same amount of heat as per the definition, both the waves should occupy the same amount of area as well. We keep the DC wave as reference and see what magnitude of AC wave will match the area. If you multiply the equation of AC wave by 2, then you will get same area for both the cases. Which means, if the magnitude of AC wave is changed from M to M root 2, then the area occupied will change its magnitude to M square into 2 pi, which will be the same area as that occupied by the squared DC wave. So taking this assumption, let us reconstruct the graph. The magnitude of the sine wave is m root 2, so when you square it, it becomes 2m squared. The area occupied by this curve will be integral of m root 2 sine x the whole square from 0 to 2 pi. And upon solving, the area will turn out to be 2m squared into pi, and it is the same result that we obtained with the squared DC wave. This means, if you take an AC wave with a magnitude of m root 2, it will generate the same amount of heat as that of a DC wave which has a magnitude m. And if you take this new wave which has a magnitude m root 2 and divide it by root 2 as per the definition, you get a value m, which is the value of the original DC wave. This is precisely what the textbook derivation says, and it holds true even with this area theory. Do check my video on average value of AC using the same concept. Drop in your comments for suggestions, give it a thumbs up, share it if you like, and subscribe to never miss an update from Explanator, where every solution has a simple explanation.